From time immemorial, man has asserted the independence of spirit and demanded the right to be treated equally and with dignity by fellow human beings. Revolts like the one led by Spartacus in ancient Greece bear testimony to this. The tide has constantly been rising. The Declaration of the Rights of Man is considered a major milestone in this context. Inspired by this, the French revolutionaries too emphasized on liberty, fraternity, and equality. Ironically, these noble pronouncements were easily forgotten by European colonizers in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. The imperial masters treated those they had vanquished with extreme racial prejudice as subhuman subjects, fit only to be treated like intelligent animals. Not surprisingly, the struggle for independence was entwined with the fight to finish against racism. The battle that Gandhi waged began in South Africa, swept through India like a wildfire, and has been a source of inspiration to oppressed people all over the world. Nelson Mandela's struggle against apartheid found wide support among those concerned with human rights. Martin Luther King Jr. rallied millions around his civil rights campaign, appealing to their concern for human rights. Other events that contributed towards growing awareness about human rights was the extermination of Jews in Nazi Germany and mistreatment of people in occupied territories by armed forces. Destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki by atom bombs also shocked the conscience of mankind. The United Nations, soon after its formation, issued a Declaration of Human Rights, asserting unequivocally that these are universal and indivisible. Fundamental rights protect the citizen only and can't be invoked by the non-citizen. But the shield of human rights knows no discrimination. It is available to all. Indivisibility of human rights means that the bundle of rights is an integrated package. One right reinforcing another. The Indian Constitution has elaborate and specific provisions regarding fundamental rights, and the chapter on directive principles of state largely covers the area concerned with human rights. India is a signatory to the UN Convention on Human Rights and has provided for all the institutional arrangements required. The National Human Rights Commission is a prime example of this. On 28 September 1993, President of India promulgated the Protection of Human Rights Ordinance. The Protection of Human Rights Act 1993 was enacted to provide for the constitution of a National Human Rights Commission, State Human Rights Commission in states, and Human Rights Court for better protection of human rights. The National Human Rights Commission is an autonomous body created by an Act of Parliament. It is committed to providing independent views on issues within the parlance of the Constitution or in law for the time being enforced for the protection of human rights. It also has the authority to grant interim relief and recommend payment of compensation damages. It is worth mentioning that in the democratic setting of the Indian Union, close to about 70,000 complaints are lodged in the Commission. That itself indicates the level of trust people have in this commission.
Universality of human rights is accepted by all countries. Not only the definition of human rights has been expanded. Civil and political rights, social, economic and cultural rights are also by 1966 convention it is approved.
The principle of human dignity, that is human beings have an intrinsic and unique value, which has to be recognized socially. From this stems not just the right to live, but the right to live a life worthy of human beings, which is the ultimate rationale of all human rights. The Human Rights Commission has a major role to play in safeguarding democracy in this country. It has many significant functions. For instance, it can inquire suo moto or on petitions presented to it by victims or any persons on their behalf, or on a direction or order of any court into complaints of violation of human rights. It can also intervene in any proceeding involving any allegation of violation of human rights pending before a court with approval of such courts. The right to life is the most fundamental of all human rights. The highest court of the land has, in a landmark judgment, expanded its scope considerably by interpreting it as the right to live with human dignity. This has been explicitly stated to include the right to food, providing adequate nourishment. India today can boast of millions of tons of food grains in its warehouses. Reports of rotting grain while millions go hungry have shocked the conscience of the nation. Countless persons in cities and villages scrounge for food. Farmers burdened by indebtedness and failing crops have been forced to commit suicide in different parts of the country. It is not only that valuable lives are lost, but entire families are reduced to destitution. This leads to an invisible but grave erosion of human rights in the countryside. The NHRC took cognizance of this problem as soon as it received information about such tragic incidents in the Vidarbha region of Maharashtra. The National Human Rights Commission has taken the matter seriously and, in association with the Supreme Court, intervened forcefully, directing the central and state governments to take immediate and effective steps to provide relief. Thanks to this, at least a semblance of normalcy has returned to scarred land and bereaved families. Legislation to ensure food security is being put in place. Right to health is inseparable from right to life and right to food. It is the state's responsibility that the ill are treated and restored to health. Unfortunately, some terrifying diseases like HIV/AIDS carry a stigma that makes even doctors shun the patients.
Children have been turned away from schools, clinics and orphanages because they or their family members are HIV positive. We have found instances where people have been denied employment or promotions due to the HIV/AIDS status. NHRC is fighting against this discrimination. HIV/AIDS affected patients also have their rights. They have right to education, right for employment, right for social acceptance, right for treatment, and thus it is necessary that these rights are honored.
The National Human Rights Commission has tirelessly campaigned to dispel misconceptions and reassured the doctors, paramedical workers and nursing staff that they aren't exposed to life-threatening infection if normal precautions are taken. Many rehabilitation centers for these patients have also been opened. The Commission has also taken effective steps that HIV-positive persons aren't discriminated against in offices and factories. It has ensured that the afflicted children aren't denied schooling opportunities that are rightfully theirs. The valley of Kashmir, that was once considered paradise on this earth, has been in throes of violent insurgency for decades, resulting in emergence of complex challenges in the context of human rights.
We receive a large number of petitions, complaints from Jammu and state of Jammu and Kashmir. Whenever we give directions, they say that you have no jurisdiction to interfere in these matters because you have got only jurisdiction in matters included in list 1 and list 3 of the 7th schedule of the constitution. But we said, suppose somebody's human rights is violated, it is not a head of legislation which we are concerned. We are concerned if there is any individual violation of human rights.
To protect the integrity of the nation and democratically elected governments, it has been necessary to deploy police, paramilitary forces and contingent of army. The men in uniform have been targeted by anti-social elements and accused of gross violations of human rights in their course of duty. In some cases, the allegations have been justified and NHRC has followed the complaints relentlessly. However, there is another side of the story. Militancy has forced the exodus of Hindu Kashmiri Pandit community from the valley. Fearing for their lives, they have fled to become refugees, a persecuted minority on the verge of losing its identity. Once well-off families have to take refuge in migration camps, nursing hopeless dreams of returning someday. Their complaint is that their plight hasn't received as much attention as other violation of human rights.
Kashmir hamara hai, Kashmir humne chhodna nahi hai, Kashmir part hamara hai, wo dil hamara hai.
The commission is aware of this dilemma and has tried its best to address their anguish. The police is expected to guard people against criminals and protect them. When the guardians themselves turn predators, whom do the victims look for relief? The commission is the point of first call, as well as last resort in most such cases. A large number of complaints received by the Human Rights Commission pertain to police atrocities, use of force disproportionate to alleged crime, and in a barbaric manner is routinely encountered. The police are notorious for extracting confessions by resorting to torture during interrogation and brutalization of those in its custody. Cases of custodial deaths have increased alarmingly.
Two-thirds of the prisoners are under trial prisoners. Sometimes they have to be in jail for more than 4 to 5 years and waiting for the trial. There are problems for these under trial. Sometimes their treatment, maybe some denied treatment, sometimes custodial torture, sometimes suicide, they commit suicide, under trial prisoners. And all these things are to be reported to the, if there is any death in custody, it is to be reported to the commission.
Refusal to register an FIR or deliberately tardy investigation by the police also result in violation of human rights of the victims of crime. A detainee or even a convict doesn't lose his human right. There also have been allegations of fake encounters to eliminate hardened criminals and suspected terrorists. In many cases, it is the intervention of NHRC that has resulted in cases being registered against guilty men in uniform and meted out justice to the aggrieved families. The Ishrat Jahan case in Gujarat illustrates how the intervention of the commission can avert a miscarriage of justice. The test of equality before law applies to persons in police or judicial custody. The commission has always come swiftly to the rescue of the victims of police atrocities and left none in doubt that in a democracy, none is above the rule of law. India shares hundreds of kilometers of porous borders with its neighbors, rendering it vulnerable to infiltration. The maritime international boundary poses similar challenges. Fishermen on high seas who inadvertently cross over into territorial waters of a neighboring state are fired upon and killed or taken prisoners. The families wait, in some cases for years, for release and return of beloved breadwinners. The problem results in similar emotions across the border too, only reinforcing the belief that the emotions of all human beings remain similar. Unfortunately, due to deteriorating security environment and the tension amongst the nations, the burden of proving innocent has become difficult. These are innocent men on both sides of the border who take this risk to nurture their families. The families of the victims have time and again pinned their hopes on the National Human Rights Commission. The Commission has played a very commendable role despite great odds in reuniting separated families. In a poor country, a person often doesn't have much choice in matters of livelihood. Any employment that promises adequate payment as wages is grabbed, oblivious of the hazard it may entail. This makes a mockery of the human rights regime that emphasizes on the right to life and right to health. Exposure to toxic waste and hazardous substances is creating life-threatening situations in disposal and recycling of electronic equipment. Unlettered workers in this sector dismantle computers and other gadgets with bare hands and without any protective gear. Getting rid of the residual waste releases toxic fumes in the atmosphere. Safety in the work environment is today ensured in many cases due to the strict watch of the National Human Rights Commission. This work has been greatly facilitated by the Commission taking effective steps to involve some NGOs and public-spirited individuals. Many traditional activities to expose workers to health hazards. Labor engaged in stone mines and stone crushing are forced to breathe in fine gravel dust that deposits in their lungs, causing debilitating and fatal disease like silicosis. The Commission is cognizant of this matter and after carrying out visits and commissioning reports has suggested measures to deal with the problem. Effective implementation of these will go a long way towards elimination of human rights violation in this area.
हम मानवाधिकार आयोग में गए थे तो बताया था कि हम आपकी पूरी पूरी कोशिश करेंगे और वो पूरी पूरी कोशिश कर भी रहे हैं जैसे कि दिल्ली सरकार को या भारत सरकार को बार बार वो चिट्ठियां भेज रहे हैं चिट्ठियां भेजने के बाद उन्होंने यही कहा कि भाई इनके लिए कुछ करो और करने पर उन्होंने ये तीन तीन लाख रुपये का उन्होंने मुआवजा तय भी कर दिया है
द कमीशन फील्स दैट कंपनसेशन टू सच विक्टिम्स इज एसेंशियल पार्ट ऑफ रिहैबिलिटेशन The tribal segment of our population is variously described as indigenous and children of forest. Ironically, the steady march of progress has driven them from their centuries and threatens to destroy their way of life. What is imperative is that they should be forcibly drawn into mainstream. In some cases, indigenous people who for generations have coexisted harmoniously in the forest have been ousted to make room for hotels and resorts in the vicinity of the forest reserves, depriving them not only of their livelihood, but also the preferred way of life. There are instances where mega industrial projects claim hundreds of hectares of forest and hills to carry out mining ores, creating a large number of internal refugees. NHRC has in some cases been able to stop ill-conceived projects that threatened adverse environmental impact and managed to safeguard the human rights of indigenous persons. Those challenged by the physical disability comprise almost 8% of our population. Unfortunately, this segment of population has traditionally been stigmatized and treated in a humiliating manner. There are many types of and different grades of disabilities. Persons suffering from a defective vision or orthopedic handicap are addressed in a derogatory manner. The Commission conducts training of the trainers program, national workshop, and 5 outreach training programs organized at protecting rights of persons with disabilities. Despite the progress in medical science, popular understanding of mental illness remains shallow, resulting in careless, inhuman treatment of the patients. Distressing condition in some leading mental hospital constrained the Supreme Court of India to order their management and functioning to be placed in the supervision of the NHRC.
They are violations, sometimes they are violations of serious violations of human rights. That is why we often our special rapporteur visit the mental health homes in all the states. They give a report to us whether the administration of these hospitals, mental homes are properly done.
The Commission continues to monitor the implementation of the task assigned to these institutions by the Supreme Court. As a result of the monitoring by the Commission, improvement have since been noticed in the working of these institutions. Admissions and discharge have been streamlined in accordance with the provisions of the Mental Health Act 1987. The Human Rights Commission is acutely aware of the problems faced by the weaker section of society, those who are either unaware of their rights or incapable of invoking them, women and children, for instance. Women in a patriarchal setup suffers multiple disabilities. Gender bias in favor of a male child has spawned ills like female infanticide and malnutrition of the girl child. They are exposed to domestic violence, sexual abuse in workplace, desertion, and dowry deaths. A separate National Commission for Women has been established, but many complaints are lodged with the NHRC, as it is perceived to have more teeth. The Commission, working in tandem with the National Commission for Women, has succeeded in providing the desired relief in many such cases. Children in poor families are exposed to several ills at the same time: malnutrition, illiteracy, sexual abuse, and bondage in child labor. Legislation related to right to education strives to liberate them from misery and empower them. Women and children comprise most of the victims of human trafficking. Some abjectly poor adolescents drift towards flesh trade as vagrants. Some are lured by unscrupulous employment agents. Others are forced into prostitution after falling prey to molestation and rape. This immoral trade flourishes in border towns where international boundaries are blurred.
There is a constitutional obligation, so far as the state is concerned, to stop trafficking completely, because one of the provisions in the Constitution debars trafficking in human beings. So that is to be enforced means the government has got to take action on that. In this area, we have sensitized them.
The NHRC monitors the situation constantly and has directed local officials to remain on high alert. It also encourages and assists the NGOs to act as eyes and ears of the law enforcement agencies to combat this ill. The NHRC is well aware that the task of rehabilitating the victims of human trafficking and flesh trade is no less important than curbing the violation of the rights of innocent youngsters. It has suggested and prompted the launching of a variety of vocational training and self-employment generating schemes to empower the victims and to restore their self-respect. Bonded labor was abolished by an ordinance followed by an act in 1975. But it is a matter of grave concern that inhuman servitude continues in some form or other under a changed name. Particularly in the construction industry, the prevailing practice of contract labor puts the worker in virtual bondage. The same can be said of child workers kept in captivity to embroider, weave carpet, or toil in small eateries. The National Human Rights Commission can take justifiable pride in the fact that its constant vigil and exertions have led to a steady decrease in the number of persons in bondage. Working closely with the Labour Ministry, the Commission reports regularly to the Supreme Court about the status of bonded labour. And the district officials are charged with the responsibility of securing immediate release of a person in bondage servitude the moment a complaint is received. The Commission follows up all such cases meticulously. The work of the National Human Rights Commission encompasses a very wide canvas. It deals with cases of violation of rights of minorities, women and children, caste-based atrocities, and those who have been brutalized by men in uniform. The Commission, along with the apex court of the country, has carved a niche for itself as an effective custodian of the rights of the individual. It has, in a span of almost two decades, helped maintain the rule of law and strengthened Indian democracy.